wants to wave us around and see what the foot I've got. If you don't stop, if you don't stop heading in this car.
All right. Good morning, all. We're here today for day two of a hearing in the matter of CF 520-2014 before Justice Sir Jeremy Cook. The claimant is represented by Brian Cave. Lead counsel is Andrew Bob Mark, assisted by Robert Williams.
May it please Your Honour, I hope you have had an opportunity to consider the WhatsApp conversations overnight.
I have read them, yes.
Yesterday, we had reached the end of what might be said to be the extraneous matters, if I can put it that way. And we now come to those parts of Mr. Hague's draft amended pleading which make allegations against GFH and or Mr. Arias and or Mr. Patel. If I may, I will deal with them in the order in which I adopt them in my skeleton argument. So first, false imprisonment, then malicious prosecution, then conspiracy. Those might be called the conspiracy allegation.
Yes.
And then the deceit, which might be called the luring allegation. And this is all, of course, against a background that part of Mr. Hague's case is that he was lured back to his jurisdiction by the claimant and its officers so that he could be detained at length by hostile law enforcement agencies doing the bidding of GFH in subjecting him to abuse and ensuring that he was, as he would put it, comprehensively disabled from defending a claim brought by us for the purpose of silencing him from whistleblowing. That is a complex and wide-ranging conspiracy. And I make two observations before I turn to Mr. Hague's pleading. The first is that on any view, anyone who alleges such a conspiracy would be expected to adduce what the House of Lords and Re H call cogent evidence to support it. It is worth remembering that Mr. Hague's allegation is not just that we set about attempting to do him down, but that we were assisted in that by the by the Dubai Prison Service, Dubai Police, the Dubai Prosecutor, and even the Dubai Criminal Court. That must be the import of his allegations. That is inherently an unlikely thing to have happened. The second observation I make is that I say it is a part of his case, because of course it's not actually an answer to how $6 million found their way into his bank account. If I may, I'll just say $6 million. It's something like 9 million dirhams, 2 million odd pounds, and $50,000. There's no answer whatsoever as to how that money found its way into his bank accounts. And on that, when we turn to his defence, which I will, with Your Honour's permission, leave till the end, Your Honour sees he's actually trying to say less than he's been saying for the last 3 years. And one must consider his allegations against that context. So,
previously he admitted that, I haven't done maths, but the vast majority, at least, I think, right in saying, of the monies had found their way into his account or roughly his account.
Yes.
But there were particular exceptions to that, were there not, where he didn't make the impression?
There were, and the reason was that we drafted our particulars of claim before we had his bank accounts. and so we drafted them to the best we could from our own records. There were in fact more false invoices, in particular the Fountain Court issue, where this arose met. There were more invoices than there were payments. And not all payment instructions were actually sent to the bank, so the audit trail is even more of a mess. But once we received the bank accounts and we were able to marry actual receipts...
You've got those on third-party disclosure from the banks?
Yes, and via a letter of request from this court to the onshore courts for the buyer.
Yes.
Once we were able to marry them, of course we were able to amend our pleading, and he never responded to the amended particulars of claim.
I don't think I've picked up the significance of the amended particulars of claim in that context.
And it's not significant to this in the sense that whether he received 58 payments or 60 payments does not affect his liability. It may have a very small impact on quantum.
Understood.
And so one may observe en passant that for a man who is quite unable to access any records or give any details and has no time to address the specifics of the case, his original defence was actually quite careful about spotting where we had pleaded payments he didn't actually receive. But for the purposes of the issue at hand, which is whether he should have permission to amend his statement of case to allege miscellaneous torts committed by GFH, Mr. Arias and Mr. Patel, Your Honour will bear in mind that none of those allegations actually amount to an answer to the claim. And his answer to the claim is even less detailed than it was 3 years ago. So the claims of false imprisonment begin, yes, at paragraph 152 to 154 of Mr. Hague's pleading.
Yes.
And Your Honour has seen that he cross-references back to paragraphs 131 to 138.
But in reality, it goes really back to the whole story of deceit and conspiracy, going as far back as some paragraph 80, or whatever it is.
Well,
paragraph 87, really. And the whole story he prays in aid, doesn't he?
He prays everything in aid, really, about how evil we are. So far as the specifics of false imprisonment are concerned.
Focusing on the actual, quote, imprisonment.
Yes, and he must, in order to make out that tort.
Yeah.
And that is, of course, an important feature. There are, I suppose, two broad issues, for Your Honour. The first is how many of these allegations he should be allowed to introduce into the trial, one way or another. A trial where the claim is in respect of his receipt of funds between December 2012 and January 2014. So the question is, how many of these allegations have any relevance? And the second question is, how many of the miscellaneous heads of claim he should be allowed to pursue? Because the even if the allegations are admitted, he characterises them as a conspiracy to injure, deceit, false imprisonment, malicious prosecution, and it's the same factual matrix which he says gives rise to, that constitutes all of these miscellaneous torts.
Yes, so in one sense it doesn't much matter what the particular head of claim is, and there are just different ways of framing a course of action based upon a series of facts.
Yes, yes.
And it'd be hard for you to resist the idea that the court should deal with such matters in the context where although they may not present a defence as such mm-hmm. to the claim, they are sufficiently related to the claim to make it sensible for the court to deal with all matters at the same time. Do you accept that? I mean, subject to your points about, for other reasons, why they shouldn't be allowed to be pursued, but in broad terms, he's got a story here that is related to,
in a broad sense, yes. I pause it.
The employment, the
yes.
individuals concerned, the facts and circumstances of that employment, albeit at a later stage to the events of which you complain.
Well, and therein lies point one. Insofar as it is claim and counterclaim arising from a sequence of transactions,
yes,
one can see Mr. Haig saying that as of December 2012, I was owed a sum of money. Over the following year and a bit, I became owed yet more money. So the court should decide not only whether he stole from us, but whether we owed him. That obviously makes sense.
But it's not just that, is it? He says that the counterclaims all arise out of the factual matrix yes. in which he was employed, because your clients had a systemic practice of falsification of invoices,
yes.
and so forth. And well, his whistleblowing was the very reason, or his potential whistleblowing was the very reason why yes. your clients acted as they did in all the respects to which he complained.
Well, yes. Now, addressing that broadly, the allegations that he's making about events subsequent to his receipt of funds do not arise out of the sequence of transactions which give rise to the claim. One may say, in very broad terms, the claim which we bring is Mr. Haig misappropriated money from us in the course of his employment. Mr. Haig's answer to that is no, the money which I received was properly due to me, and what is more money is due to me. That is his case, but he has a subsidiary case, which is if the court is against me and I did steal the money, then I'm actually owed more than I stole. Now that's a, we would say, a very unattractive case, but that appears to be his subsidiary case, and that gives rise to his counterclaim as well. And one can see in the abstract, I'll address Your Honour in due course on the specifics of this particular case, but in the abstract one can see that that is also properly the subject of a counterclaim. Where he then seeks to say the allegation against me has been fabricated, that is his defence. And insofar as Your Honour is satisfied it has any merit whatsoever, if it also amounts to an actionable tort, I think the question Your Honour is putting to me is, would I then resist the bringing of a counterclaim for that actionable tort, given that the court will be dealing with the factual matrix as part of the defence in any event? And in the abstract, the answer to that must be, whether I object to it or not, the court will order that happen. But what the court should not sanction on this issue is multiple heads of claim arising out of the same set of facts without specific loss being pleaded. One can see a further or alternatively if the claim may amount to X, Y, or Z. But that's not how this is pleaded. Mr. Haig seeks, it would appear, judgment in his favour on allegations of conspiracy to injure, deceit, false imprisonment, and malicious prosecution under different heads, and libel. Now, so far as libel is concerned, in this abstract, in this general discussion. So far as libel is concerned, it's completely independent. It has nothing whatever to do with the dealings between the parties. And Your Honour has seen, I've addressed the merits of the libel in any libel claim, such as it is in any event. But purely as a question of, is it proper to bring that together, this. I have in mind things like shareholder disputes, where two business partners who have worked together closely for perhaps a decade or two have a falling out. And the court can find itself faced with a ever-expanding factual matrix as each side says, but if you're going to say that, then you have to look at that, and you have to look at that, and you have to look at that. One thing that Mr. Haig never actually addresses anywhere in his 70-odd page document, so far as the allegation of systematic false accounting is concerned, why on earth it would apply to him. It's well and good that he says that those who were others extracting money improperly would cover it with false invoices. It's well and good that he alleges that sanctions busting was achieved through false invoicing. It's well and good that he alleges that gross breaches of listing rules and DFSA rules were covered up through false records. What is he alleging was the purpose of covering up what he says were legitimate payments due to him? He never addresses that. And in that respect, the Court of Appeal said Mr. Haig should be able to adduce his oral evidence. What the Court of Appeal did not say was Mr. Haig should be permitted to use a trial as a platform to simply hurl allegations in the general direction of GFH and anyone who's done business with it.
At the end of the day, if one's looking at counterclaims,
yes,
without regard to whether they constitute a legal set-off or an equitable set-off.
Yes.
In the end, it's always a matter of simply the convenience of the court to decide, does it make sense as a matter of efficiency and economy from the court's perspective for these matters to be tried together? I mean, it's simple as that.
Yes.
And broadly speaking here, If the claims are realistically maintainable, it makes sense for the court to deal with all that at the same time, doesn't it?
I would invite you to take this approach. Because of course, there are two questions. One is the abstract approach to counterclaims in general, and the other is to the specific approach to these alleged counterclaims.
Yes.
And in the abstract, quite clearly, it is not an efficient use of either the court's time or anybody's resources for there to be a sequence of claims between the same parties,
right,
raising roughly related issues with a trial of each in turn. That obviously makes
even
no sense.
Issues where, although the factual basis for the cause of action may be different, much the same factual areas are going to have to be explored on the evidence in any event.
If it's the same factual areas, then yes. And perhaps that's the dividing line.
Yes, well, I think that is the debate.
Yes, what the court should not
say there's a discrete element of fact here that doesn't repeat itself elsewhere, all well and good, but otherwise the court's inclined to take a broad view and say, well, we better hear all this evidence together and decide all the disputes.
Well, in that respect, of course, I understand what Your Honour means by that, but from the perspective of any judgment or indeed any broader message, there is a dividing line to be drawn between the court resolving the issues which have arisen as a result of a factual matrix or a sequence of dealing between the parties, and the court simply being asked to act as a general arbiter of the relationship between the parties, to hear a sequence of unrelated claims in an attempt almost to sort of balance the books between them. If Your Honour understands what I mean, that for example, parties aren't free to come along and make one claim relating to 2012 and a contract, another claim relating to 2014 and an employment dispute, another claim relating to 2017 and an allegation of libel, and to somehow clear the decks between the parties. But, obviously, as a matter of general policy, the court should consider certainly a single factual matrix together and determine all of the claims and counterclaims that arise out of it. And indeed, in RDC 18.9, which I've referred to at the end of my sketch and I'll come back to, the implication is that where a factual matrix has been pleaded and some relief has already been sought in respect of it, parties should be given permission to add additional claims in order to make sure that everything is brought before the court for the efficient disposal of the issues between them. Where, however, the new claim, the additional claim, is something that hasn't featured hitherto, then the rules of this court would appear to suggest that it is not inclined to allow the parties to simply add claims. In other words, the dividing line may be that this is a sequence of facts. Now, as claim and counterclaim have been made, the heads of claim have expanded and maybe the parties have expanded. What parties are not allowed to do is to come before the court and say, and another thing. But with that, perhaps it's of assistance if I then turn to the specific heads of claim. And in my submission, there are two ways of approaching this. One is whether there is any real prospect of success, and the other is whether even if the allegations are made out, they're going to amount to the tort alleged. And I deal with the alleged torts in the way that I do, because the ones that I deal with first in my submission, even if Mr. Hay can make out his allegation of conspiracy, they don't amount to the tort which he is alleging, even if they amount to a different tort. So in essence, one of clearing the decks of heads of claim the court might have to deal with. And so with that I turn, if I may, first to false imprisonment. And the reason that I say Mr. Haig limits his plea to paragraphs 131 to 138 is because that's what he says in terms of paragraph 152. But I suspect he really means paragraphs 130 to 130.
He says, at least in the version I have, 131 to check.
We've got a slightly later version because he's taking the word check out.
Oh,
no, no, you're right. I'm sorry, you're quite right. It's 131 check.
Yes.
Yeah. So, obviously,
so that I think one's entitled to cast about to see
a little bit
what he might conceivably have in mind.
Well, and what he has in mind, which is quite clearly, is 130 onwards. And the reason for that is that false imprisonment is a very specific tort. He has to actually be detained. And paragraph 130 is where the story of his detention begins. The conspiracy...
Well, it begins at 129.
Well, I don't take the point.
Anyway.
Because in my submission, the gravamen of his claim is encapsulated at paragraph 138.
Yes.
On page 37.
Yes.
Where it says, the claimant had it within their control, to ensure the release of the defendant on bail. They declined to do so. Instead, the claimant sought to use the defendant's freedom as a bargaining chip in settlement discussions. The claimant had it within their control to have Mr. Haig released and the accusation against him dropped. So So, the allegation seems to be pretty clear. Mr. Haig was only in prison because we declined to exercise our power to ensure his release on bail.
Or to drop the accusation.
Well, one or
the two things. Either you could have released funds from the frozen account so he could have his bail.
Ah, no, I'm sorry. If I could interrupt you on there. No. The freezing order was varied on the return date of 14th of June 2014 to permit Mr. Haig to expend frozen money for the purposes of posting a bail bond.
Yes.
So we never prevented him from posting a bail bond.
And at all times, the freezing order here and in the UK.
Yes.
Had that.
Absolutely.
The visa.
Absolutely. And Your Honour,
well, in which case, what is there other than that it was within your control to say we're not pressing charges and therefore the accusation is dropped?
Other than that, I think what he's trying to suggest is that we could have said to the court and or the public prosecutor, we'd be very happy for him to have bail without the need to post any sort of bond. In other words, we could have proactively pursued his release on bail. Now, whether that be right or wrong, as I'm going to take Your Honour to in a moment, that's simply not the tort of false imprisonment.
No, I've got that point. I'm more interested at the moment in, so to speak, the foundation of the of the accusation about
yes,
within your control. You submit that there's no reason why he couldn't have put up bail by reference to the funds frozen, subject to whatever the amount is, of course.
Well, that's the point.
Do we know that?
Well, as far as I'm aware, what happened was Mr. Haig was actually granted bail at a very early stage by the prosecutor. But the bail was set on terms that included the surrender of his passport and the posting of a bail bond of 24 million dirhams.
Which is?
The equivalent of, at the time, it was $5 million. Or is it about $5 million? It's the amount that we allege he stole in total in dirhams, or did at that stage. So in other words, the prosecutor said, well, if you put up the amount of money that you said, that is said you stole, you can have bail. Now, now, of course,
I take it that you don't know how much funds were frozen.
Well, we know what we've identified.
Which is how much?
And in terms of cash, at the time, something like £972,000 was frozen. Pounds. Which at the time would have been getting on for 6 million dirhams. Of course, part of the issue with that is £200,000 was then spent, of that money was spent in September 2014 on Stevenson Harwood. So far as whether this was money which has been sitting in a bank account which Mr. Haig could have been using for bail, actually, we now know from evidence in London, all of it has been spent.
All of what?
£972,000. Okay. Or 20-odd thousand pounds.
Well,
so, I mean, the balance of what we've identified is real property, which Mr. Haig bought with our, we say, with our money.
Yes.
So, really, the reason that Mr. Haig was detained for as long as he was in custody is that he couldn't post a 24 million dirham bail bond, and neither the prosecutor nor the court were minded to reduce it.
So the reality of it, on what must essentially be common ground as far as the facts are concerned, is that the claim works only on the basis that you ought to sell it, release him without any security,
yes,
or you ought to have said, we drop the charges.
Yes. Now, in fairness to Mr. Haig, looking at paragraphs 129 to 138 to 137, Mr. Haig seems to be in some way asserting that we were positively going about securing his detention and his mistreatment there. But
where do you get that from?
Well, because the general content of paragraphs 129 and onwards, because of the references to Mr. Mairdas, to my submissions, in fact, my submissions that he complains about, one can say en passant, had to do with the fact that that Stevenson Harwood were writing public letters of thanks to the authorities. Mr. Haig was tweeting that he had no complaint about the way he was being treated by the Dubai authorities, and then in London he was alleging systematic abuse and mistreatment. And so, and he was complaining that it was outrageous that the Dubai authorities might find out about this, and he wanted the hearing held in private in London. So I submitted that, well, if the reality is that he's in fact enjoying special privileges of one other point, and he's coming to London to say he's being systematically abused by those providing such special privileges, they're entitled to know. The special privilege, in no small measure, was Mr. Haig makes en passant. Mr. Haig makes no... Mr. Haig makes much of the lack of access to lawyers.
Yeah.
And I don't know whether Your Honour is familiar with difficulties with accessing, with legal visits in English prisons.
Certainly. Very familiar.
Indeed, I'm sure, in fact, indeed, when you're sat in the Crown Court, I'm sure you had occasion to list cases for mention at 9:30 purely so their counsel could spend the day in the cells with their client.
Yes, or video links or whatever.
Yeah. Yes. One of the complaints which Mr. Haig makes is about events on the 17th of March of 2014. I don't know whether he actually particularises, I think he does at some stage, where he suggests that Mr. Mairdas visited with the criminal complaint that he was making in London, and that the prison, the officer in charge of the detention centre said to him, "Now I've been very good to you." And one of the witnesses he called was a solicitor from Oldswang, who was complaining about the outrageous nature of how he'd had to take instructions together with two other solicitors and leading counsel in a room which had been made available to him for 2 days, 2 full days. Now, he chose to use those 2 full days to progress his criminal prosecution in London, his private prosecution in London, rather than his defence to this claim. But the suggestion that the prison served, that is the context in which Your Honour is considering his allegations of systematic mistreatment by the authority.
Well, something he wouldn't have had. I understand what you're saying, but as soon as the court gets into investigating facts, there's a problem, isn't there?
Well, there is, but we say Your Honour doesn't need to.
No,
because
that's what I'm much more interested in focusing on.
Because the law, as set out in Iqbal, which I've taken Your Honour to in the skeleton argument,
yeah.
And I've taken Your Honour to the relevant paragraph within the skeleton argument, I don't know whether I need to turn up the authority itself.
Well, it depends if there's more to add than appears in your...
Well, it must that sets out very clearly what there is, particularly as Your Honour has the nub of Mr. Haig's complaint on false imprisonment.
Yes.
Leave aside the conspiracy to injure, that's a different issue for later.
Yeah.
But on false imprisonment, Your Honour has the nub of it, which is an omission on our part to set about attempting to secure his release. And what Iqbal says is pure omission is not sufficient. There must be a positive act. And therefore, even if paragraphs 132 and 138 are admissible and proven, they don't amount to, whatever else they may amount to, they don't amount to the tort of false imprisonment.
Yes.
And one can add, what Mr. Hague is really complaining about is the decision of the public prosecutor or the court, as Mr. Chandler said to a final witness, which made it clear that Mr. Hague was being reviewed monthly by a court. The decisions of the public prosecutor and the court, the bi-criminal court, authorising his detention.
Yes.
Which is to allege false imprisonment as a essentially an appeal against the refusal of bail.
And you say that raises the Hunter point?
Quite clearly. Yes. Even if it was brought against the jailer. In essence, Mr. Hague is almost asserting that the complainant in a criminal case has a positive duty to bring about the release on bail of the defendant.
Can you just take me very briefly to both the passage you allow in Iqbal and Hunter?
Yes.
And this recurs in other contexts too.
It does. Hunter will recur repeatedly. Perhaps if I begin then with Hunter,
yes,
slide 15. Now, Hunter is a very well-known My research has suggested, in fact, Your Honour has had cause to look at it in this court not too long ago. But it is the... I don't expect that Your Honour will
have any clear
recall. But this was the Birmingham 6 case. And it's difficult... Mr. Hague... And I'm sure Mr. Jones would wish to make a great deal of the fact that this is the Birmingham 6 case.
Yes.
Given what happened subsequently. But this is 1981, in fact. The decision is November 1981. Mm-hmm. And following their conviction, the Birmingham 6 sought essentially to challenge the conviction by bringing charges or bringing a civil claim for assault against the officers who had taken the confessions, which it has to be said have subsequently been held not to have been properly obtained.
Yes.
But not necessarily on the basis of the assault. But they brought a civil claim for assault, and it was pretty obvious to all and sundry that the true purpose was to undermine the safety of the conviction. The core of the conviction was a voir dire by Mr. Justice Bridge to assess whether or not the police had proven that they did not beat a confession out of the defendants, to use a shorthand, in which he found in favour of the police. And Your Honour sees page 539 of the report, letter E, and this is Lord Diplock setting up the facts. The statement of claim in the present civil action relating against the police, the identical assault that had been canvassed for 8 days before Mr. Justice Bridge and the voir dire, and again before the jury on Hunter's trial for murder, was delivered in January 1978. Prompt steps were taken by the police to have the statement of claim against him struck out and the action against him stayed or dismissed, or else under the Aaron Jurisdiction Report, on the grounds inter alia that it was an abusive process of the court. And so that's what happened to the statement of claim. The There is then over the page a description of the proceedings in the Court of Appeal and Lord Denning being in favour of extending the description of issue estoppel. But at the foot of the page, having said that there, the distinction between issue estoppel and abuse of process is one of semantics, and saying that Lord Diplock says it could not possibly affect the outcome, hearing any further. Nevertheless, letter H, nevertheless, it is my view, which I understand is shared by all your lordships, that it would be best, in order to avoid confusion, if the use of the description of issue estoppel, in English law, at any rate, does not appear to have been adopted in the United States, were restricted to that species of estoppel per rem judicatum that may arise in civil actions between the same parties or their privies, of which the characteristics are stated in a judgment of my own in Mills and Cooper. It is adopted and approved by this House in Crown and Humphreys, a case in which is also held that issue estoppel had no place in English criminal law. Yeah. The abuse of process, which the instant case exemplifies, is the initiation of proceedings in a court of justice for the purpose of mounting a collateral attack upon a final decision against the intending plaintiff, which has been made by another court of competent jurisdiction in previous proceedings, in which the intending plaintiff had a full opportunity of contesting the decision in the court by which it was made. And then I refer, Your Honour, to letters C to H, and just above letter F, the paragraph beginning, it would call for a degree of credulity too extreme to be expected even from judicial members of your lordship's house to fail to recognise that the dominant purpose of this action and the parallel actions brought by the other Birmingham bombs, so far as they are brought against the police, has not been to recover damages, but has brought an endeavour to establish, long after the event, when memories have faded and witnesses other than the Birmingham bombs themselves may be difficult to trace, that the confessions and the evidence on which they were convicted were induced by police violence with a view to putting pressure on the Home Secretary to release them from the life sentences that they are otherwise likely to continue to serve for many years to come. So at the very foot of the page, beginning with my lords, below letter H, my lords, collateral attack upon a final decision of a court of competent jurisdiction may take a variety of forms. It is not surprising that no reported case is to be found in which the facts present a precise parallel with those of the instant case. But the principle applicable is, in my view, simply and clearly stated in those passages from the judgment of Lord Justice A.L. Smith in Stevenson and Ginetti, and the speech of Lord Halsbury in Reichel and McGrath, which is cited by Lord Justice Gough in his judgment in the instant case. I need only repeat an extract from the passage which he cites from the judgment of Lord Justice A.L. Smith. Quote, the court ought to be slow to strike out a statement of claim or defence and to dismiss an action as frivolous and vexatious. Yet it ought to do so when, as here, it has been shown that the identical question sought to be raised had been already decided by a competent court. The passage from Lord Halsbury's speech deserves repetition here in full. Quote, I think it would be a scandal to the administration of justice if the same question having been disposed of by one case, the litigant would be permitted by changing the form of the proceedings to set up the same case again. In the instant case, the relevant final decision by a competent court in which the identical questions ought to be raised here has already been decided. It's the ruling of Mr. Justice Bridge on the voir dire in the murder trial that Hunter's confession was admissible. Initially, his ruling may have been provisional in the limited sense that up to the time that the jury brought in their verdict, he had power to reconsider it in the light of any further evidence that might emerge from when the whole question, the circumstances in which the confession was obtained, was gone into again before the jury on the question of the weight to be attached to it. But his ruling became final when the trial ended with the return of the jury's verdict of guilty and the pronouncement by the judge of the mandatory sentence of life imprisonment. Mr. Justice Bridge thereupon became functus officio. His ruling that the confession was not obtained by the use of violence by the police, as Hunter had alleged, could thereafter only be upset upon appeal to the Court of Appeal Criminal Division. The fact that the whole matter of the circumstances in which the confession was obtained was gone into a second time before the jury, in view of the judge's direction to them, must clearly also have been satisfied beyond reasonable doubt that Hunter's account of the assaults upon him by the police was a fabrication, does not affect the finality of the judge's ruling, though it would exacerbate the public scandal to the administration of justice that would be involved if Hunter, by changing the form of the proceedings to a civil action, were to be permitted to set up in that action the same case that must have been decided against him not only once but twice, even though technically it was only the first of those decisions that eventually qualified as the final decision against him.
Well, why Why is it only the first of those decisions? Because the jury decision is not specific, so to speak, in relation to that particular issue.
I think the reason that English law...
Jury doesn't give reasons for what it does.
That's it. That's exactly it. Yes. And, of course, en passant, one may point out this because it becomes relevant in the malicious prosecution. An acquittal is not a finding of innocence.
No.
There is one famous miscarriage of justice case where the Court of Appeal highlighted the distinction and said this is not a declaration of innocence, far from it.
This is a diversion, but in the context of practice in criminal courts now, which is to give the juries routes to verdict, where they have to answer specific questions, it would be open to say that the jury had in fact made a specific finding on the point if there had been such a route to verdict that they had to answer a series of yes-no questions. This is said to justify the jury system in the light of various European and human rights type authorities.
It's an interesting debate, it would certainly be a very interesting debate to be had in front of the Criminal Division of the Court of Appeal, which I'm sure it will be had at some stage before too long.
I'm sure.
Speaking as somebody who's addressed juries before, including in complex cases where judges prepared routes to verdict, and having seen the questions posed afterwards, from a personal perspective, I'm not sure that they would constitute reasons in the same way that a judicial decision with reasons given leading to each conclusion.
Your doubt arises because of the questions the juries have asked the judge.
Yes. May not necessarily indicate that they see the
fully grasp the significance of the route to verdict they're supposed to adopt.
Or that they see their route to verdict as somewhat different to how the lawyers have seen it.
Well, that of course is the difficulty. Yeah.
Yes, and one may say the beauty of the jury system. It's been said to be the shining light.
Or the defect of it, yes.
Depending on your point of view, yes.
Yes, exactly so.
Yes. Some may say the ultimate bulwark against oppression.
Yes. There's that.
It's encapsulated in the phrase, it's an old case, and every man is entitled to seek a perverse acquittal.
Yes.
But returning then to Hunter and the general principle.
Yes, well, I got that.
As Your Honour sees, the general principle is that once a matter has been decided by a court of competent jurisdiction, it is an abuse of process to bring proceedings to mount a collateral attack upon them. And so really we say that in part the false imprisonment allegation is a Hunter type abuse because it's a collateral attack on the bail decisions that were being made. The authority specific to bail decisions is Iqbal. And Iqbal, Your Honour, finds behind divided six of the authorities by.
Thank you.
This was a curious case. A young man sentenced to 15 years imprisonment had his daily routine upset by what was admitted to be a wildcat strike by the Prison Officers Association. By wildcat, I mean that everybody accepted it was a completely unlawful strike and was called at no notice in order to prevent the prison service from obtaining an injunction preventing it. Mr. Iqbal brought a claim against the Prison Officers Association for false imprisonment. Because rather than being allowed out of his cell to conduct his daily routine, he'd been locked in it all day. And this raised a number of interesting questions of civil liberties. It being 2010, it did not receive the short shrift it might have done 20 or 30 years earlier. And instead, Lord Newburger of Abbotsbury, then Master of the Rolls, took some care over the issues. And he begins his preliminary remarks as a above regarding false imprisonment, paragraph 9 of his judgment, page 738 of the report. But that relates to the specific position of prisoners and the statutory right of a prison governor to detain them. So that nobody can be liable for false imprisonment for being a prison governor.
Yes.
But paragraph 50, so we have a section on liability for a pure remission begins. Lord Newburger says, in Smith and Littlewood's organisation, Lord Gough of Chifley said that the common law does not impose liability for what are called pure remissions. Specifically in relation to the tort of false imprisonment, it seems to me that this proposition derives support from Heard and Weardale Steel, Coal and Coke Limited, affirmed by the House of Lords. In that case, the Court of Appeal, by a majority, Lord Justice Buckley and Hamilton, reversed Mr. Justice Pickford's upholding of a false imprisonment claim by an employee of a coal mining company whose complaint was based on his employer's refusal to comply with his request to take him to the surface after he had wrongfully refused to do work until more than 2 hours after his request had been made. Lord Justice Buckley first considered the contention that the employee had a claim in contract, which he rejected on the basis that while there was an implied term that the employee would be brought to the surface, it had not been breached as the plaintiff had been brought to the surface by the end of his shift. He then turned to the claim in false imprisonment and said, what kept the plaintiff from getting to the surface was not any act which the defendants did, but the fact that he was at the bottom of a deep shaft, and that there was no means of getting out other than the particular means which belonged to his employers and over which the plaintiff had contractual rights which at the moment were not in operation. At page 789, Lord Justice Buckley considered what the position would have been if there had been an hour's delay in conveying an employee to the surface at the end of his shift, merely on the grounds of the employer's convenience. He said that in such a case, in his opinion, the employee would be entitled to damages for breach of contract, and then asked, would there be any false imprisonment? He answered that question, in my opinion, there would not. The master was not imprisoned, has not imprisoned the man. He has not enabled him to get out, as under the contract he ought to have done, but he has done no act compelling him to remain there. A little later he added, to my mind, the employers did not imprison the employee because they did not keep him in the mine. They only abstained from giving him facilities for getting away.
Yeah.
And so there is then a more deep, more analysis.
Yeah.
But at paragraph 29 of page 740, letter G. And this is the conclusion of Lord Newburger. It seems to me that the reasoning in the Heard case supports the first proposition advanced by Mr. Bellock, which is also reflected in Street on Torts, where this is, there is this, quote, a false imprisonment will normally, emphasis added, result with from some positive act, close quote. I would put the point in these terms. At least as a general principle, defendants are not to be held liable in tort for the results of their inaction in the absence of a specific duty to act, a duty which would normally arise out of the particular relationship between the claimant and the defendant. Such a hard and fast distinction between action and inaction may seem arbitrary to some people, but it is not unprincipled. And, while it may lead to apparent injustice in particular cases, it does help to ensure a degree of clarity and certainty in the law. However, a general rule, such as that propounded by Lord Gough in the Smith case, and applied by the majority of the Court of Appeal in the Heard case, can often, perhaps inevitably, be said to beg the question at issue, which it is relied on in a particular case. Accordingly, the question which arises here is whether the going on strike constituted a, quote, pure, unquote, omission on the part of the prison officers. It might be said that it was a positive wrong because they were under duty to comply with the governor's directions, and therefore their failure to let the claimant out of his cell on the 29th of August 2007 was wrongful. The problem with that argument, as I see it, is that the duty concerned was owed by the officers to the governor or to their employer, not to the prisoners. In effect, the argument effectively amounts to saying that a prison officer owes to the prisoners in the prison in which he works a duty in tort to comply with the terms of his employment contract, or a duty not to withdraw his labour. That cannot be right, and I note that such a contention was abandoned as effectively unarguable, even at an interlocutory hearing. In the apparent proof of the Court of Appeal in Tunier and Evans. It is true.
I read through to the end of paragraph 23.
And so, in the same way, even if they be right that we could have taken positive steps to seek to influence the judicial process in onshore Dubai, our failure to do so can't amount to the tort of false imprisonment. And that is assuming Mr. Hague can get over the hurdle of his false imprisonment claim looking very much like a collateral attack on the bail decisions.
Yeah. Yes.
So, with that, I turn to malicious prosecution, if I may. Unless I can assist you on a further on the question of...
Well, I think my question is this. Looking at this head of claim, is it possible to see that in a discrete way, which means that I should make a ruling on it now, or better to see it in the round in the context of the other alleged torts and deal with them all in one go?
I think it may be better if you're on the deals with them all in one go.
Very good.
Not least because, as Your Honour has identified, that there is some nexus between
the various. Yes, understood. Yes, thank you.
And so I turn next, if I may, as I say, to the malicious prosecution allegations. They begin at paragraph 140 of the pleading. Mm. And go through to paragraph 151.
Yes.
Now, paragraph 140 is very easy to deal with. It alleges that the breach of trust allegation, the embezzlement allegation on which Mr. Hay was convicted, was brought falsely by us.
Yeah.
If that's not a Hunter abuse, I don't know what is. In fact, it's even worse,
yes.
Some may say.
Yes, well, that's straightforward.
Yes. The more difficult question, as you identified before we rose yesterday, is the Twitter, what are referred to as the Twitter allegations. Now, I should say, my instructions are that these allegations are first raised with the Dubai police. Several months before proceedings began, in the late spring of 2015, but the police at that stage weren't particularly interested in actioning them until they knew what had happened with Mr. Hague's embezzlement. Be that as it may, that's not in evidence before, Your Honour, and I'm not inviting Your Honour to conduct a mini-trial of exactly where the claims alleged made their Twitter allegations. There is in the law of Dubai still the offence of criminal libel.
Yes.
The fact that it has been removed from English law for some considerable time does not alter the law of Dubai, any more than the fact that debtors' prison was abolished in the 1920s in the law of England and Wales affects the way that debt is dealt with in onshore Dubai or any other emirate. So one must consider what is malicious prosecution. And again, we've had recent and comprehensive guidance from the Supreme Court. I took Your Honour yesterday to the Crawford of Justice case, the Privy Council decision. I didn't go to the analysis of malicious prosecution. And Your Honour will shortly discover why, because if I invite Your Honour to turn to Divider 11.
Yeah.
Your Honour sees Willis and Joyce. Willis and Joyce was a Supreme Court decision had followed Crawford to justice with something of a convergence of members. And the leading speech of even judgment being given by Lord Tulson.
Nine
judge court. And they split 5-4.
Yes.
There were only two left. I think this might have, I don't know whether this was a period when there was a vacancy. I know that two vacancies came up in the Supreme Court in very short succession last year. But I don't know. But anyway, it's a nine judge court. It's a 5-4 split. And the reason it's a 5-4 split and the importance of it is that this was the Supreme Court case which finally decided that as a matter of domestic English law, as opposed to the Privy Council's decision, which was technically a matter of Cayman law, the tort of malicious prosecution is to be extended to civil proceedings. Or as Lord Tulson would say, the tort of malicious prosecution has always extended to civil proceedings and the misunderstanding should be corrected.
Yes, well, the usual fiction.
Well, in fairness, this is another. Your Honour recalls that Crawford Justice, the analysis began in 1285.
Yes,
this one,
the first.
I think they only skip a little bit of that in this. And in fact, one of the things that's identified is that in the very old cases on malicious prosecution, there was actually no distinction drawn. But the important point is that Lord Tulson, I commend this as an analysis for Your Honour. But if I could invite Your Honour first to turn to paragraph 42, page 343. This is the conclusion of Lord Tulson's analysis of the case law.
And he was, that's the leading speech,
yes,
with the majority. Four others agreed.
Yes, he's speaking for the majority.
Yes.
And Your Honour will not be surprised, given the convergence of conclusions. Lord Wilson, who Your Honour will recall, gave the leading opinion in Crawford to Justice, was with Lord Tulson on that.
Yes.
So paragraph 42 is the conclusion of Lord Tulson's analysis of the authorities. The common law is prized for its combination of principle and pragmatism. The doctrine of precedent, in the words of Dean Roscoe Pound, is one of reason applied to experience. This citation is given. Growth, he said, is ensured in that the limits of the principle are not fixed authoritatively once and for all, but are discovered gradually by a process of inclusion and exclusion as cases arise which bring out its practical workings and prove how far it may be made to do justice in its actual operation. Quote. The case law on the tort of malicious prosecution is in point. It shows how the courts have fashioned the tort to do justice in various situations in which a person has suffered injury in consequence of the malicious, that's an important word, you want to see in a moment, malicious use of legal process without any reasonable basis. Drawing on that experience, the court has to decide whether the tort should now apply to the malicious and groundless prosecution of a civil claim causing damage of the kinds alleged in the present case. This requires consideration of the justice and practical consequences, whichever way the question is decided. In considering those consequences, it is appropriate to have in mind the essential ingredients of the tort, although they were not the subject of argument. See paragraphs 52 to 56. And if we turn to paragraph 56, it's part of the policy, paragraph 52, it's part of the policy considerations. Under the heading Uncertainty as to Malice.
Yeah.
Lord Tulson says, it is suggested that a decision in Mr. Willis' favour would take the courts into new and uncertain waters about the meaning of malice. The requirement of malice has been considered in the past at the highest level, for example, in Glinsky and McIver. And Gibson Ray. No argument was addressed to the court in the present case on this issue for understandable reasons. If the facts alleged by Mr. Willis are substantiated, there was undoubtedly malice on the part of Mr. Gubin. Lord Mance expresses concern about the concept of malice in the context of a claim. Lord Mance was in the minority.
Yeah.
Of a claim for malicious prosecution of civil proceedings. I make two preliminary observations. First, the subject was not raised in either party's written or oral arguments for understandable reasons. Mr. Willis' case is that Mr. Gubay well knew that Mr. Willis had done Mr. Gubay's bidding in the matter of Langston's claim against the Aqua directors, and the prosecution of Langston's claim against Mr. Willis was part of Mr. Gubay's vendetta against him. Secondly, over the last 400 years, there has been a volume of case law about malice and the related requirement of absence of reasonable and probable cause for the purposes of the tort of malicious prosecution. Most of it has not been cited, and the court has not had the benefit of the party's analysis of it. I recognise that Lord Mance's registering a concern rather than seeking to lay down doctrine. It would be wrong for me to ignore that concern, but anything that I say on this aspect is necessarily over to the right to bring that to the owner's attention. But this is one of those overture analyses that is essentially the reasoning. In the early case law, Chief Justice Hobart stated the requirements succinctly in the passage from his judgment in Whatever and Freeman, cited in paragraph 17 above. Quote, if a man sue me in a proper court, yet if his suit be utterly without ground of truth, and that certainly known to himself, I may have an action of the case against him. This, Your Honour knows the idea of action of the case, the old words, a tort for special damage. This formula was adopted.
You usually referred to as action in the case, as I recall it.
Well, this is going so far back that.
Anyway, no matter.
This formula was adopted by Justice Blackburn in 1869, when Wren and Weld. It accords with Lord Mance's suggestion, paragraph 139 below, that he would be ready to accept a concept of malicious prosecution, quote, which depended on actual appreciation that the original claim was unfounded. Chief Justice Hobart's statement remains a helpful starting point, and speaking in general terms, it has, in my view, much to commend it. It is well established that the requirements of absence of reasonable and probable cause and malice are separate requirements, although they may be entwined. See, for example, Dinsky and MacIver. In the quotation given in parentheses, it is a commonplace that in order to succeed in an action for malicious prosecution, the plaintiff must prove both that the defendant was actuated by malice and that he had no reasonable and probable cause for prosecuting. End quote. That's a quote from Lord Devon. In order to have reasonable and probable cause, the defendant does not have to believe that the proceedings will succeed. It is enough that on the material on which he acted, there was a proper case to lay before the court. Paragraph 55, malice is an additional requirement. In the early cases, such as Savile and Roberts, the courts used the expression falso e malitioso. In the 19th century, malitioso was replaced by the word malicious, which came to be used frequently both in statutes and in common law cases. In Bromwich and Prosser, Justice Bailey said that, quote, malice in common acceptation means ill will against a person, but in its legal sense, it means a wrongful act done intentionally without just cause or excuse. His statement was cited with approval by Lord Davy in Amberley Flood, and reference for a recent discussion of the 19th century understanding of the weak meaning of malicious in the law of tort, see Opio and Roth. As applied to malicious prosecution, it requires the claimant to prove that the defendant deliberately misused the process of the court. The most obvious case is where the claimant can prove that the defendant brought the proceedings in the knowledge that they were without foundation, as in Chief Justice Hobart's formulation. But the authorities show that there may be other instances of abuse. A person, for example, may be indifferent whether the allegation is supported and may bring the proceedings not for a bona fide purpose of trying that issue, but to secure some extraneous benefit to which he has no colour of a right. The critical feature which has to be proved is that the proceedings instituted by the defendants are not a bona fide use of the court's process. In the Crawford case, which I did run to yesterday, Mr. Deloso knew that there was no proper basis for making allegations of fraud against Mr. Patterson, but he did so in order to destroy Mr. Patterson's business and reputation. Paragraph 56, the combination of requirements that the claimant must prove not only the absence of reasonable probable cause, but also that the defendant did not have a bona fide to bring the proceedings, means that the claimant has a heavy burden to discharge. That then is the elements of malicious prosecution.
Yeah.
And albeit it's an obiter dictum, it's a powerful obiter dictum clearly intended to provide guidance hereafter, certainly grounding the ratio of the case, which is that there is no good reason why the tort of malicious prosecution should not be extended to civil proceedings. Therefore, as I said in my skeleton argument, what Mr. Haig must prove under this head is both a lack of belief on the part of GFH Capital that there was any proper case to put before the court, and secondly, that the proceedings in question were not a bona fide use of the court's process.
Where are you reading from, Matt?
That's in my skeleton argument.
Yes,
paragraph 29.
29?
Well, paragraph 28 summarises Williamson Joyce. And what I say in paragraph 29 is that Mr. Haig must prove that when we made our complaint to the Dubai authorities about his comments on social media, we had no genuine belief that there was a proper case to put before those authorities. Now, the first thing that Your Honour will note is nowhere in paragraphs 141 to 151 does Mr. Haig actually suggest that what was on his social media account is other than defamatory. And his defence would appear to be that it could not be proved that he was the one operating his social media account from prison. Once again, nowhere in paragraph 141 to 151 is there any attempt to dissociate himself with anything that was said on his social media account. So, can I invite Your Honour to take up the additional bundle? And we now return to Mr. Dugan's additional
bundle. Trying to see exactly what has been pleaded here.
Yes.
So he specifically pleaded cause and maliciously.
Yes.
So the drafter has had regard to the terms of Willis and Joyce on the principles.
Either Willis and Joyce or some of the other established case law on the topic of
prior.
Yes.
Yes.
One can see some lack of detail, but...
Well, lack of detail, I understand, but in terms of the plea itself...
But the plea itself, the plea at paragraph 149 is a plea of malicious prosecution known to the law.
Yeah.
The question is whether... There's any real under this heading is whether there's any real prospect of this of that claim ever getting off the ground. Mr. Hague must show that there was no reasonable, that we had no reasonable foundation for making the allegations we did. As I said, if I could invite you to take up the additional one, and to turn to paragraph, to divide 66. Paragraphs 36 and 42 show the extent of the pressure that was being exerted on the claim from various sources while Mr. Hague was in prison, apparently isolated. But then, out of his own mouth, one sees I'm afraid I'm going to take you on a few, it's something of a document trawl. Page 338, please, within this divider. The second paragraph. In messages sent from prison to his personal assistant.
What am I reading from
here? What you're reading from is The Guardian, Wednesday, the 4th of February of 2015. So whilst Mr. Hague was in prison, apparently incommunicado, detained without trial, being subject to systematic abuse. In messages sent from prison to his personal assistant, Hague says that he was initially promised bail, but was then challenged by a young police officer to sign a statement in Arabic, which he refused. Then, under pressure, signed and wrote, "I do not understand Arabic," but being forced to sign. Since then, Hague says nobody has been to see him or questioned him at all in relation to any criminal prosecution. He's been kept in prison for 8 months. The only legal process, and so on. So that's the first. The second, if I can ask you to turn to page 347. This is from the BBC's website. Former Leeds United managing director David Hague has revealed how spending nearly 300 days in the Dubai prison has driven him to the brink of suicide.
347.
347. Last May, after being accused of fraud by Leeds' former owners and his former employer, GFH Capital, he is currently in custody as authorities decide whether to pursue a criminal case. Because it was the darkest time of my life, said Hague. I was suicidal. Speaking to charity Prisoners Abroad from his cell, he added, "I just wanted it all to end, to get rid of the fear." This is 14th of March 2015. And if I can invite you to turn to page 351. This is from Arab Business. March 14th. The state paid the former Leeds United managing director held in jail in Dubai for 300 days without question in trial or charge has revealed his incarceration threatened to the brink of suicide. In a dramatic interview with the charity Prisoners Abroad, Haig said of his early days, I was beyond desperate, I was suicidal, I even planned to hang myself on the cell door and managed to find some strong material. I just wanted it all to end, to get rid of the fear, desperation and the pain. It was crushing. That's the same interview.
Yeah.
Picked up by, say, Prisoners Abroad has got a traction of at least two. Then, something we submit is quite remarkable. I invite you to turn towards the end of this part, this exhibit, page 582. Sorry, 584. Mm-hmm. Now, it takes two pages for this Mail Online article. The date, as you want to see, published 28th of April 2015.
29th, isn't it?
29th of April 2015. Updated 29th of August 2015.
Yeah, okay.
And the opening words. David Haig has borrowed a device off a prison guard to make a call on Skype. He has no idea if he will get 5 minutes or 40 to tell his extraordinary story. Now, Your Honour, I'm sure, is familiar, at least in outline, with the regime in UK prisons. Even having a mobile phone on the wing is a serious disciplinary offence, much less a prison guard lending it to an inmate to call outside. Now, at the time, much was made about whether this was evidence of Mr. Haig's being held incommunicado. But given that he now seeks to plead malicious prosecution with respect to the allegation that he was operating a Twitter account, Your Honour must ask, does he have any reasonable prospect, or any realistic prospect, of proving that we had no reasonable foundation for reporting what Mr. Haig does not appear to allege were other than libelous comments, or Mr. Haig does not allege to be other than his social media account, to the Dubai authorities? And it may be that Mr. Haig would wish to say, but we still had no real, still it was a terrible experience and that he was dumbed down with respect to the Twitter allegations. This does not prove that we obviously had reasonable cause in our own minds. But in terms of the objective facts, Can I ask Your Honour to turn in the additional bundle to divide the 64? And to page 80.
Page 84.
And that's behind divider 64.
Yeah.
So, if I explain for a moment the genesis of this document, shortly after we launched the process in London, and Mr. Hague made an application in the United Kingdom concerning the Section 25 freezing order, it became clear that he and his sister, Alison Thomas, had fallen out in quite a spectacular manner. And she gave us an affidavit which exposed quite a lot about Mr. Hague's contact. Now, the reason that Your Honour sees blacked out things is because they've been redacted, because Mr. Hague was concerned that these would give away the identity of individuals who had been helping him in Dubai whilst he was in prison.
This is an Alison Thomas. No, this is a note from him.
This is a note from him.
Yeah.
Dated 15th of June 2015, which is probably about right because it says date 394.
Yeah.
It says, "Dear Alison Stewart," Alison is his sister, Stewart is her husband. And I see that Your Honour has been highlighting. And Your Honour is ahead of me. Number one, Twitter. Please can you get the password for, and then the individual is identified, at Hague David, check with blank and reset, and then don't, underlined, use it unless I approve. And then a list of tweets follows. So as it happened, had this material been available to the criminal court in Dubai, it's far from clear that the proceedings would have ended in the way that they did. But I'm not permitted to go behind the acquittal.
No.
What I can say is an acquittal is not a declaration of innocence. And that would appear to be the reality of the position. But I do rely on Mr. Hague's own comments to the media about his ability to access the outside world and his ability to obtain communication devices from prison guards. If the issue is whether we had reasonable and probable cause for believing that he was operating his own Twitter account, well, he did that to himself. And therefore we say, leaving aside what our purpose was, there was probable cause. And then the issue is whether we ever had any intention of seeing it through. And we did. It so happens that the Dubai court, as Mr. Hague himself pleads, the Dubai court was as robust with us as it was with him, in respect to the embezzlement charges and repeated requests for adjournment. But in my submission, that is the end of the malicious prosecution. I accept that Your Honour will next put to me, that may be right, but that doesn't put an end to the claim for conspiracy to injure. Well, my submission, paragraphs 155 to 157, are really a different way of framing the same allegations.
Just bear with me. Sorry, we're going on to conspiracy.
Yes, well, conspiracy to injure in respect of the Twitter charges, because there's a separate plea in paragraph 155. And we say that's basically the same plea, phrased in a different way. It's a conspiracy to injure by unlawful means, the unlawful means.
Yeah, if the unlawful means disappear, then...
then the conspiracy disappears with it.
Yeah.
We said. And the next point is the libel claim, which is paragraph 158 to 162. Now,
this is a very short point in one sense, isn't it?
Well, it is. He hasn't actually pleaded any specifics of what was said, when, in what context, or to whom.
Which, as my recollection and my... it's a long time since I looked at defamation, but one of the clear things you have to do is to be very specific about what was said, do you not? Is there authority for that?
Oh, there is. It so happens Mr. Dukins is an expert in libel and so on, having spent a large part of his early career in Michigan at Carter Ruck and doing precisely this kind of work. And I actually asked him if there was authority akin to Willem Joyce, which simply set out the elements of libel. And he told me, if there is, then please tell me the editors of Gately, because it's unknown. There is a raft of case law on the point.
Yeah. I was just thinking that ordinarily one would, again, find something in the White Book that simply set that out.
No, there isn't.
Is there not?
There is in the White Book, but it's in the rule, which of course isn't interpreting something else.
Mr. Dugan very helpfully says it. There is a special rule relating to defamation proceedings, which then sets out, but that's within the CPR, it doesn't apply within the...
It's not the notes.
No, I follow, but the question is if that reflects the common law.
Well, I note the time, and it may well be that we'll be back with these briefly after the short adjournment, and so over the short adjournment we'll have a look in the White Book. Or Mr. Dugan says he'll be going out reading it now.
I would like to see some. I have a recollection.
It's not a...
recollection. It's not foolproof, and I would to see
certainly some
chapter and verse on the subject, even if it's a statement that comes out of...
Oh, of course.
Paul's original or something.
If I may, I should refer to the experts to my left. The short point is that Your Honour, we've said quite right that without a detailed knowledge of the law of life and Islam, the first thing one must do is plead precisely what was said, when, in what platform, and to whom. And that is wholly lacking. And we say, not only does the fact that Mr. Hague is able to plead with the detail that he does when it suits his purpose point to the fact that he should be given little leeway, but in this particular instance, paragraph 159 purports to be direct quotations. If he's able to give direct quotations, then he must have had the document in front of him which he was quoting. And still there are no particulars of it. There's no excuse at all for that. So we say that is the case, but then Skeletor argument goes one step further. This plea appears to be made independently of any finding that's made with respect to what we say was his fraud, or indeed independently of the fact of his conviction. Mr. Hague would have absolutely no complaint had Mr. Patel been recorded as saying, Mr. Hague has been convicted of fraud.
Sure.
Mr. Hague is being detained on allegations of fraud. So really, the complaint appears to be that Mr. Hague is described as a liar.
Well, it goes further than that, because as pleaded,
yes,
it talks about, in specific context, derailing Leeds United and stolen fans' money, as opposed to taking GFH's money.
Well, that we we need to see exactly what the specific context is. And that's the vice of the lack of any particulars.
Well, I see that. But the question is what one does in the circumstances.
And the question, but of course, the other question is, to what extent is he likely to recover anything substantial? Having it, on the assumption that Your Honour finds the fraud made out, is he likely to recover any substantial damages for being called a fraudster and a liar, as opposed to just a fraudster?
Well, I suppose in the eyes of right-thinking Leeds United football supporters.
Yes. Well, the answer
brackets,
is not, so but there lies a particular vice, is why you want to see it, excitement to my left. The test is not right-thinking Leeds United fans. The test is right-thinking people. And I don't by that mean in any way to disparage Leeds United football fans. What the point is...
I might be tempted to do so.
That is precisely the point, Your Honour. Football engenders, especially in the United Kingdom, a tribal loyalty.
Well, of course it does.
And a very particular set of emotions in its primitive facts. The law of libel is precisely calculated to avoid people litigating about offence caused to a very particular group of individuals. It's not the right thinking Leeds United fan, but I have to say, accusing somebody of stealing money belonging to fans,
yes,
of a football club, is on its face a defamatory statement.
Yes.
And that's why it must go to an argument. I haven't sought to argue that if there are proper particulars, that these statements couldn't be defamatory. What I've said is there aren't sufficient particulars to enable anybody to plead to it sensibly. But if there are, then the Jamil test, which is not purely libel.
But in that context, if we were talking about the party that was represented by lawyers,
yes,
the application would be to strike out on the basis is embarrassing for want of particulars because you wouldn't be able to plead to it.
Yes.
And I guess the question here is, does one adopt the same approach,
yes,
in circumstances where Mr. Hague is apparently not represented, though it's quite plain he's had access to some legal assistance, at least.
Yes.
That's the way I read the pleading. The way certain of the pleas are formulated doesn't mean he's had access to a defamation specialist, of course.
Well, Your Honour, he's not entitled to access to a sequence of specialists for whatever allegations he wishes to bring. That's point one.
I, in a sense, would be surprised if he didn't have some knowledge of
point two.
The rules of court relating to defamation. UK, well, simply because of the whole business of football, where these issues tend to arise rather more often than elsewhere, I fear.
Yes, I'm pausing only because I don't think that Mr. Hague's involvement with football was quite as involved as he would like to make out.
Yes, I see.
He was our deputy chief executive.
Yes.
He was only on the board of Leeds United because he learned it.
Yes. No, I understand.
It's far from saying that he is a football executive. Having been involved in the course celebre that was the Harry Redknapp prosecution, having been engaged in with the business of football, as it were. I should say I don't represent Mr. Redknapp, I represent his co-defendant, who did own football clubs and does understand the business.
And did understand income tax laws.
Whatever was
no, no need to comment.
It wasn't income tax evasion. the point is that so far as Mr. Hague and his status as a litigant in person is concerned, a few points arise. Firstly, whoever has assisted with this pleading is obviously a highly skilled lawyer. And whilst the law of defamation is complex at its margins, is a constantly evolving thing, is a difficult area when it comes up against the freedom of the press and the freedom of expression. The basics, such as what was said, when, and to whom, might be said to be well within the purview of any competent lawyer. Second, perhaps it's worth considering the full details of these. And I'll just read them into the record. Paragraph 158. The defendant is collating all the evidence of libel and slander and was unable to provide the full details at the time available, such has been the volume of the libel and slander of the defendant by the claimant, whom appointed no less than 3 PR advisers to damage the reputation of the defendant. Paragraph 159. On X-2015 dates, the following statements were made regarding the defendant by the claimant and specifically by Mr. Patel. So he's got a list of five statements there, all of which are at least 2 years old, anywhere between 2 and 3 years old. That list purports to be direct quotations. Now, if they're direct quotations, he can expect that he actually had the documents he was quoting from in front of him when this was pleaded, whether it be Mr. Haig or someone assisting him, or both. And still no details, not even of the dates. Paragraph 160. Numerous other defamatory statements were made regarding the defendant by the claimant, and specifically by Mr. Patel and the company Woodstock Lesser, acting as agent for the claimant, to a wide range of media. These will be more fully particularised in the revised amended defence and counterclaim and cannot be particularised here due to illness and insufficiency of time. Yeah. Your Honour is ahead of me for what I'm about to say in repeatedly in regards to Mr. Haig's repeated reference to a revised defence and counterclaim, that he purports to have reserved to himself the right to file at some stage in some unspecified date in the future. But if he had the time and the wherewithal to prepare 100 paragraphs of why the United Arab Emirates is in breach of the United Nations Declaration on Fundamental Human Rights, closely argued with the different categories of deprivation of liberty, he had the time and effort, he had the time and resources, and those who assisted him had the time and resources, to look up the basics of the law of libel and what needs to be pleaded, and indeed to collate those matters on which he wishes to rely. And if it be the case that he ran out of time, that was as a result of his own choice. So there is a limit to how much slack the court should cut Mr. Haig. Firstly, because there is a question mark over how much he is truly a litigant in person. Second, he is a qualified solicitor. It's no good Mr. Haig saying, "I am an English qualified solicitor," at the start of every witness statement. And then when it's pointed out that he has a legal qualification, speaking, say, "Well, actually, that's not a real, I'm not a litigator, I'm a fund lawyer, I know nothing about court proceedings." Third, it is one thing to say, well, Mr. Haig, had Mr. Haig omitted a technical requirement, so meaning, for example, against a libel specialist member of the bar, I would take the point, well, it's his own omission, and his clients have their remedy against him if it's his negligence that did it, against a litigant in person. It would not carry much, at that point would not have much traction, and probably it would give a chance to amend the pleading to correct the oversight. But when there is absolutely nothing by way of particulars, and indeed the pleading itself says I'm not providing particulars at this stage. Then it frankly makes a mockery of the rules to permit this sort of thing to continue. And indeed, in the very particular circumstances of this case, I'd invite you on to be very careful. The whole reason that we are here is Mr. Haig saying, I have a detailed defence to bring. And the Court of Appeal saying, well, we'll give you one final opportunity to present that detailed defence. Now, Mr. Haig, if this pleading had any veracity at all, has had this claim available to him for over 2 years. He wasn't shy of bringing a private prosecution. He wasn't shy of launching process in this court and the United Kingdom. And he wasn't shy of pursuing a judicial review all the way through 2016. He wasn't shy of applications to this court and appeals to this court. So the question is whether it is a proper use of the court's time to permit Mr. Haig to essentially open up a new flank by alleging libel completely out of the blue, by definition unrelated to anything to do with financial entitlements between the parties, because he doesn't even allege it happened until 2015 at the earliest, wholly lacking in particulars, but running the danger that if Your Honour were to say, he's a litigant in person, so I'll give him a chance to give more detail, then Mr. Haig will be taking that as an implicit recognition that he does have the right to file an amended defence and counterclaim, which again will lack any full particulars, and have another reservation of a right to file yet another amended defence and counterclaim in due course. But there's one thing that Mr. Haig is, one thing that has been the constant refrain of Mr. Haig since September of 2014, is that he has a full answer to this claim, he just hasn't yet had the time to present it. In my submission, this libel pleading is embarrassing for want of particulars. That is a deliberate choice on the part of Mr. Haig. One can see it to be a deliberate choice on the part of Mr. Haig. But if there is any veracity in his suggestion that he has run out of time, it is because he has chosen the approach that he has chosen. It is not a proper counterclaim in the sense of being a claim arising from the dealings between the parties. And so Your Honour can be quite comfortable in striking it out. Even if we're wrong, and as a final point, paragraph 162. The statements were sent to Leeds United football fans and published to the BBC in the UK, and then distributed to a wide media audience by the PR of the claimant. So it would appear that if Mr. Haig really feels very strongly about this, there is a sufficient nexus with the United Kingdom that he can bring this claim against Mr. Patel and or the claimant in the United Kingdom. And all this on this. But the point is, but we're not shutting Mr. Haig out altogether. Mr. Dugan points out that he has a limitation issue under the Defamation Act. I don't know that for sure. The Defamation Act doesn't apply in Dubai because it's a UK statute. I have come across the debates about the extent to which, because of the waterfall in the law, which law one would apply. My fear is this being the Emirate of Dubai, albeit a free zone, one would actually be applying the Emirati law of libel before one applied the English law of libel, leaving aside the debate about whether English law imports the body of English statutory law.
Well, it's procedural, isn't it, limitation?
Yes.
Procedural, not substantive, so I'm not quite sure how that impacts on it either.
No, well, the other difficulty is, of course, that defamation has been the subject of very close consideration by Parliament in the United United Kingdom because of the impact of the Convention on Human Rights and then the impact of events and the events that gave rise to it. So it's a nightmare. And indeed, Your Honour, Your Honour talks about judicial convenience and the efficiency of resolving all matters between the parties. Not just this libel claim. Your Honour may think there's a flavour of this across the board with the alleged counterclaims. And to some extent, even the whistleblowing allegation, which I'll come to. Mr. Hague is doing the exact opposite of seeking an efficient resolution of this case. In fact, he's seeking to make it as disproportionate, as unwieldy, and as complicated as he can possibly manage. And in my submission here, the plea, the wholly unparticularized plea of libel, which is said to be wholesale, wide-ranging, and severely damaging, but which he is too ill and lacks the time to particularize in any way at all, is an example of that. I invite Your Honour to simply strike out, to not permit Mr. Hague to make the amendments of paragraphs 158 to 162. Indeed, as a final point, I do return to the Jamil principle. And that is the quotation of it's not only not worth the candle, it's not worth the wick. As I say, the idea that Mr. Hague's reputation is substantially damaged, and any real harm, actionable harm, will give rise to any meaningful damages. Because he is called a liar and a fraudster rather than merely a fraudster, is fanciful. Would it assist if I went to Jamil, but the reference is in my smartphone? I therefore turn to what is really the nub of Mr. Hague's complaint, which is the claim of conspiracy and deceit. And once again, I highlight to you, Your Honour, I've been talking now for 2 hours. You've yet to actually come to Mr. Hague's defence to this claim. The claim of deceit begins at paragraph 87, Mr. Hague's pleading. And it runs through the following pages to paragraph, really, 135.
Yes.
And this is why I said there's a complete overlap. This plea is, the pleas of false imprisonment and malicious prosecution are wholly subsumed within these pleas. Mm-hmm. Now, these paragraphs must in turn be read in the context of paragraphs 7 to 17G. One can spend a very great deal of time deconstructing these paragraphs, try to identify a coherent narrative in Mr. Hague's case. And we submit that's precisely what Mr. Hague is trying to achieve, that everybody spends a great deal of time and effort and money trying to identify a coherent narrative within these multiple paragraphs. Rather than doing that, Your Honour's permission, I will focus on what it appears to actually be his core complaint, which is that he was lured to Dubai. That's the claim of deceit. He was lured to Dubai, as he would put it, on false pretenses. Now, this is why I now turn to the WhatsApp conversations. Mm. Now, in my skeleton argument, I've highlighted the passages that matter. Sorry, I'm just kidding. Perhaps if we could begin. Page 461 is behind the back, it's tab 66. But I don't know, you're on an extract.
Yes, but can you mind which tab it goes on? So I
66.
Put it back.
Yes. 66. But it may be convenient for your own.
Yes.
So page 461. This is when Mr. Haig is still employed by Leeds United Football Club. He is recently resigned from the claimant. And if his case be right in paragraph 17 to 17g, he is saying to us that he is about to blow the whistle on serious alleged impropriety which he's discovered. Leading to our entering into the conspiracy he alleges. Now, perhaps if we pick it up, 1st of April, Mr. Alreyes, saying to Mr. Haig, okay, we'll call in answer to call when you can. 8:37 p.m. Mr. Haig, are you calling me? 8:41, hello. So he's actively pursuing conversation with Mr.
Yeah, well, most of these exchanges are of a similar kind.
Yeah.
But what one doesn't know is whether there were telephone calls that were in fact made.
Yes. But what one sees repeatedly is Mr. Haig actively pursuing conversations with Mr. Alreyes.
Yes.
And that is important because Mr. Haig's complaint appears to be that we were pursuing him to say, come back to us. Secondly, it's important because if Mr. Haig's case is right, this is a man who is saying, I'm going to blow the whistle at you. You're a bunch of criminals, I'm blowing the whistle. One must contrast that with the man who is speaking in these WhatsApp messages. And in that, immediately after, it says hello. 8:41, Mr. Araya is still in office, leaving shortly. 8:43, Mr. Haig, I'm getting very paranoid on who I can trust. Mr. Araya, me too. Then Mr. Haig, are you calling me? Mr. Haig, what's going on, please? You shall, of course, David. Have a million things to do. Half hour max. Mr. Haig, we all need to be communicating. Mr. Haig, you know, I'm all alone here, put on a limb, taking abuse for all you guys and doing my best. Mr. Haig, for everyone. Mr. Haig, I feel like no one trusts me. Mr. Haig, like with HMRC and Landlord, why don't you trust me? Mr. Arreaz, we'll call you and discuss that. Okay. And then turns off, then turn to football. Page This is the following day, the 2nd of April of 2014. This is late at night. Towards the top of the page.
Yeah.
This is our, again, this is following a discussion about Mr. Cellino and various allegations against him, which are quite salacious. Mr. Haig says, at top of page 463, 11:47:09 and 9 seconds p.m., David Haig, at the end of the day, I spent 7 years with GFH and you are all family. This is the man below the whistle, that you're a bunch of criminals. Mr. Arreaz, thanks. David Haig, some druggy nutter liar ain't going to sway me. By the way, the druggy nutter liar is Mr. Cellino.
No, I realise that.
David Haig, please, can you approve my, I don't know what lot it, my note?
Note.
And so, sent email, but I'd recommend you pay it was. And then they move to discussions about the club. Page 465. Mm-hmm. Towards the foot of the page. A man who is blowing the whistle, being hostile. Mr. Arreaz, I told you to come to the F1. This is the time of the bar. I think this would be Bahrain. David Haig, I can't with all this going on. It wouldn't have been right. I think there's not seen there when players not paid, etc. I want to come only because I miss Mona. Ha ha. And then they move back to football. So the suggestion that he was happily managing Leeds United, minding his own business, and was being actively pursued because he had said he was going to threaten, because he was threatening to blow the whistle, simply gainsaid by this sequence of exchanges. So paragraph 91 of the draft amended defence and counterclaim says...
91,
page 29.
Yeah.
In early April 2014, Mr. Arreaz and Mr. Patel spoke with the defendant, purporting to gauge his interest in a potential new role as deal broker and media advisor for the claimant. Well, you're just seeing the conversations with Mr. Arreaz in early 2014. But one can track through his discussions about a new post. 5th of April, 8:29 p.m. So that's going back to page 465. So 8:29 and 54, it's about a quarter of the way up the page.
Yeah.
Anyways, be stressful day. I find the guy, sort the deal out, and have no job in Dubai. Maybe not Leeds now, and no commission. That's the starting point.
Yeah.
Page 468. 6th of April, 10:10 p.m. Next to the whole punch. I feel like GFH have totally left me out to take all the crap. I'm very upset. I'm here trying to protect GFH and no one supports me. Chronologically, the next in time is with Mr. Patel, but if I may, rather than jumping backwards and forwards. Page 469, please. 7th of April, 10:34 p.m. It's about a quarter of the way. Why wouldn't you let me be the GFH director? You said you would. No one is supporting me. I'm being hung out dry here, and it's not right. Again, the next in time is Mr. Patel. But if I may, I will pick it up. 8th of April. And 11:59 p.m. And it's really the top, the start of the long passages from this
page. Yeah.
You know, I found GFH Massimo. I did the deal. I convinced you all to be patient. I made sure he got approval. At first, Mr. Cellino was refused the approval of the Football Association to buy GFH. And now what do I get? Zero support. Very upset. Mr. Arez, why do you say this? Mr. Arez, you told me that you are okay if he pays you. Mr. Hay, he hasn't paid me, nor will he. Also, I have asked 10 times for the commission you promised. My name has been made to look so bad. I have said nothing. You have all hung me out to dry and left me. And you can't be even bothered to meet me when I came from Leeds to discuss this. GFH have made a huge mistake in letting him, that'll be Mr. Cellino, get everything he wants. I doubt very much he will pay the other amounts if I'm not around. Page 470.
I'm not sure where this is getting us, Mr. Bodman.
Well, where this is getting us, Your Honour, is...
I've read through this material. I understand what you're saying. Not a trace of any suggestion of whistleblowing. That much I see.
There's also not a trace of any suggestion of Mr. Haig being pursued for a new job.
No, but as one gets to the end of it, we'll see there are discussions about the possibility. And questions as to whether one, he's going to meet in London, two, he's going to meet in Bahrain, three, he's going to meet in Dubai. And in the end, there is agreement, if I can put it that way, that he will go to Dubai and meet Dr. K, whose name escapes me.
Yes. That is entirely...
I summarised, I hope we speak.
Where I was coming to next, actually it's a little more than that. Having resigned from Leeds United, Mr. Haig then started to pester Mr. Aurelius and in turn Mr. Patel for a new job.
Yes.
It began with General Counsel, he answered, and so on and so forth. And the passages are in my skeleton argument. If it's not assisting Your Honour, I won't go through them line by line.
Well, the real question is this, Mr. Bodman. As soon as one gets into issues of fact,
yes,
and one has to bear in mind that we're only seeing some WhatsApp conversations which make reference to the possibility of telephone calls which may or may not have taken place.
Yes.
And once, if we're looking at the facts, one would need to explore all of that to know exactly what was going on.
Well, one needs to explore the facts if this is a claim which gets off the ground.
Well, I follow that. The question is, can you show on the material that it can be said there's no realistic prospects of success in Mr. Haig contending that he was lured, to use his word, to come to Dubai on the offer of a job, or the offer of a discussion of the topic, then?
Well, I've just shown you, Your Honour, the first premise, paragraph 91 of the plea, is directly contradicted by the available evidence. It's Mr. Hake who's chosen not to provide any meaningful evidence in support of this application. The paragraph 91, and with respect, it's not for us to try to find ways in which Mr. Hake might be able to prove his case. And then
no, but it is for you in this context to show that there are no realistic prospects of success.
So the first question is whether Mr. Hake has any real prospect of showing that in early April 2014, Mr. Arreaz and Mr. Patel spoke with him purporting to gauge his interest in a potential new role as deal broker and media advisor for the claimant. Now, Your Honour is right that there may be phone calls, but what Mr. Hake would have to be asserting is that whilst he was writing, I have no job, you guys are not supporting me, I'm being left out to dry, he was in fact having phone calls with with the same people to whom he was writing in those terms, where they were actively encouraging him to take on a new post with them as deal broker. He would then have to establish that whilst writing to say, I'd like to be general counsel, or if that's not going to work, I can come and work in India, or I can work in London, or if I find work in London, will you give me a commission and a business card saying consultant? Or I have a contact in Africa who is about to become a member of the government, leading to lots of investment opportunities. He was in fact being pursued over the telephone by Mr. Patel and Mr. Arreaz, saying please come and work for us as a deal broker and media advisor. In other words, the WhatsApp conversations fundamentally undermine these allegations. And what Your Honour has seen as the conversations unfold is that what happened, in fact, was that GFH simply didn't prevent Mr. Hake from coming back. Which is not the same as deceit. The elements of the tort of deceit, again the subject of relatively recent Supreme Court authority. And if I could invite Your Honour to take up the authority's bundle again. And turn to divide 40.
Yeah.
Supreme Court case, Hayward and Zurich Insurance. This is a fraudulent insurance claim.
Yeah.
And the issue was whether a settlement of litigation could be set aside because of the deceit of the claim or of the defendant. The leading judgment was given by a Lord Clark.
Mm-hmm.
And in this case, there was only five justices, three of whom agreed with Lord Clark. Lord Tulson, in fact, concurred in the result. The judgment is passage isn't quite clear as to the elements of the tort of deceit. It is to be found most clearly in Lord Tolson's speech. In passing, I refer, Your Honour, to paragraph 18 and following of Lord Clark, simply because that is where he addresses these issues. But Lord Tolson, as might be expected, gives succinct analysis. Paragraph 58. And it should be said that Lord Newburger, Lady Hale, and Lord Reed agreed with Lord Tolson. Paragraph 58. To establish the tort of deceit, it must be shown that the defendant dishonestly, it's important, I'll come back to it in a moment, made a material false representation, which was intended to, and did, induce the representee to act to its detriment. The elements essential for liability can be broken down under three headings. A, the making of a materially false representation, defendant's conduct element. B, the defendant's accompanying state of mind, the fault element. And C, the impact on the representee, the causation element. Where liability is established, it remains for the claimant to establish D, the amount of any resulting loss, the quantum element. And then he turns to the elements of the particular case. But in this case, what matters is the concept of dishonesty, which was the subject, again, of even more recent Supreme Court consideration. And it is the case of Ivy, which is divided 30. Now, Ivy is a case that has caused a very great deal of excitement at the criminal bar, because it reverses Gosch, or Gosch, depending on how one likes to pronounce it. It in fact brings the criminal law into line with the civil law. And indeed, it's Lord Hughes who is giving the judgment, with which everyone else agrees. Paragraph 74 gives the new definition of dishonesty. And it's page 1235, it's the penultimate page of the report. These several considerations provide convincing grounds for holding the second leg of the test propounded in Crown and Gosch does not correctly represent the law, and the directions based upon it ought no longer to be given. The test of dishonesty is as set out by Lord Nichols in Royal Brunei Airlines and TAN, and by Lord Hoffman in Barlow Clouds and Eurotrust International. When dishonesty is in question, a fact-finding tribunal must first ascertain subjectively the actual state of the individual's knowledge or belief as to the facts. The reasonableness or otherwise of his belief is a matter of evidence, often in practice determinative, going to whether he held the belief, but it is not an additional requirement that his belief must be reasonable. The question is whether it is genuinely held. When once his actual state of mind as to knowledge or belief as to facts is established, the question whether his conduct was honest or dishonest is to be determined by the fact finder by applying the objective standards of ordinary decent people. There is no requirement that the defendant must appreciate that what he has done is, by those standards, dishonest. So, Mr. Haig's plea of deceit is to be found encapsulated in paragraph 136A. And because B and C are intent to a conspiracy. As pleaded, and again, Mr. Haig has had assistance from those who know legal drafting. If he's chosen not to plead this with care, that's a matter for him. As pleaded, he must establish that the representations which Mr. Al-Reyes and Mr. Patel actually made were materially false. Nowhere is Mr. Haig actually is Mr. Haig told you are going to receive a new position. He's told you're going to have an interview, you're told it should be okay, but he's told many things. Nowhere is he told you must come to Dubai. Second, he must show that when those representations were made, the conduct was dishonest by the objective standards of ordinary, reasonable people. Not the standards of Mr. Haig or his lawyers, the objective standards of ordinary, reasonable people. So Mr. Haig must establish that by the standards of ordinary, reasonable people, if somebody who you suspect has defrauded you is insistent on returning to your office, it is dishonest not to tell him that if he does, he will be arrested. He wasn't coerced. In any way, shape or form. And third, they would have to show, he has to show that the representations which were in fact made were the cause of, firstly, of Mr. Haig resigning from Leeds United, which, as I've just shown you, is clearly not the case, and secondly, were the cause of him travelling to Dubai overnight. Because that is what is pleaded at the foot of paragraph 136A. The deceit induced this paragraph, page 37, the deceit induced the defendant to resign his employment with LUFC and to travel to Dubai under false pretences. Mr. Haig's real complaint is that he wasn't told as soon as he started to make contact to say, I'd like to come back, actually, we're about to sue you for fraud. But the question is whether by objective standards it was dishonest not to tell him that if he came to Dubai he'd have to be arrested. And it has to be said, he tried this in the criminal proceedings. This was the foundation of his allegations, seeking warrants for the arrest of Mr. Al-Reyes and Mr. Patel. He then, at that time, he called it conspiracy to defraud and conspiracy to traffic him for the purposes of exploitation. Now it's called conspiracy, now it's called deceit.
Well, as I understand it, there was no decision against him at that point, effectively abandoned.
Not effectively, he did. It's dismissed for want of prosecution. The district judge didn't let him withdraw it with no decision. There's no decision on the merits.
No, that's what I mean.
And so it's not res judicata, he's free to keep on.
But, Mr. Bodner, as soon as we get into the facts, you know, there's a problem from this court's perspective. The court can't determine the facts. If the plea is inadequate to constitute the tort at which complaint is made, that's an entirely different matter. But I looked at 136 and trying to work out, as a matter of analysis, what's being said.
Yes.
What is the deceit or fraudulent misrepresentation in question? And it's said to be misrepresentation by Mr. Al-Reyes and Mr. Patel.
Yes,
ma'am. Things said that were untruthful. First, that he was being offered. Now, what does that mean, a new position? It's a representation that we intend to offer him?
Well, this is the problem.
I mean, you know, either is an offer.
Yes.
Factually. yes. which was capable of acceptance.
Yes.
But or there is a representation of some kind, of a state of mind, that they were going to make him an offer and pay him all those monies due.
Yes.
On the face of what I've read in the WhatsApp, one can't say that. He was going to see Mr. Dr. Carlead.
Yes.
With a view to Carlead, who was a board member, carrying out some sort of review to decide whether or not he might be offered a job.
Quite.
That's how it appears.
Yes.
But I don't know, obviously, what other exchanges there were between the parties, and it's not right to assume that the WhatsApp exchanges constitute the whole because of the constant reference to "Will you call me?"
Well, the difficulty is one then has to look at what Mr. Hay has pleaded in that case.
Well, I know, and that's why I'm asking you to focus on what he's pleaded and therefore whether it is capable of constituting the tort in question. If it is capable, then at present I see real difficulty in not allowing him to proceed. If it's not capable of constituting the tort in question, then there's plainly no really small prospect of success, no reasonable course of action being pleaded, and no basis for permission to be given.
Well, perhaps imagine that indication. If we go through the paragraphs that have been pleaded and analyse those.
Well, that's what I'd like you to do. I'm afraid I find as soon as one gets into the facts, I do not see how this court can possibly start passing a judgment at this stage on them.
Well, I hear what you want to say, so perhaps if we go through the paragraphs first.
Yes.
So the first representation is, in early April, Mr. Arreaz and Mr. Patel spoke with the defendant purporting to gauge his interest in potential involved in giving advice. But that's not a representation.
Sorry, where are you reading now?
Paragraph 91.
Thank you. Right, yes, back to there, yes. Yes, no representation, and you also say no evidence.
Yes.
Okay.
One can go back to the preceding paragraph.
Yeah.
Where he suggests that Mr. Gray, who is not intended as a defendant,
no.
assured Mr. Hay that he would never work against him.
Well, I don't quite see how that yes. can be laid at the door of the defendants as matters, the claimants as matters stand.
Yes.
So.
And paragraph 88 is a WhatsApp exchange with Mr. Nuruddin,
allegedly,
is not a representation. Paragraph 91, not a representation.
Indeed.
Paragraph 92, not a representation.
Well, just take me to those paragraphs that are capable of amounting to representations, or at least arguably capable of amounting to representations.
So paragraph 93. Mr. Arreaz and Mr. Patel met with the defendant in London to discuss this potential.
Again, there's nothing there.
No. Well, he would say that's a representation. But it's not. Paragraph 94 has nothing to do with representations. Paragraph 95 is about Mr. Gray. Yeah. Paragraph 96 says, in light of these discussions,
yes, well, I don't have any problems here because I don't think
well,
there's any
paragraph
allegation.
136A1. Because if paragraph 136A
yeah, well,
is right.
That's the focus that I have at the present because I can't for the moment.
Well, paragraph 96 is Mr. Hague saying, I resign the 11th of April based on these discussions.
Yes.
So he has to identify a deceit which caused him to resign his employment with LUFC on the 11th of April. And Your Honour has not accepted that anything in the preceding paragraphs constitutes a representation of any sort, much less a dishonest one, a dishonest and false one.
Yes.
Paragraph 97.
Yeah.
Mr. Patel is said to have asked if Mr. Yeah. Hague would come to Dubai.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Not a representation.
Yeah. Well, as I say, I don't see any representations at present.
Well, if Your Honour doesn't see any representations as so advised, and Your Honour was really challenging to see whether I had, then Your Honour and I are divided. There is no representation. Really, the point of going through the WhatsApp conversation was to cut to the chase. What was Mr. Hague actually promised, if anything?
Where's his recitation of WhatsApp? Oh, it's very early on, isn't it?
Yes. No, his only reference to WhatsApp is paragraph 88 in Mr. Meridian.
And what?
There is then a discussion. He then goes to the WhatsApp conversations, beginning paragraph 99.
Okay.
Defendant messaged Mr. Larrea stating that he was thinking about a move back to Dubai and asked whether he would become general counsel. He could become general counsel at GFA rather than the role proposed at the 9th of April meeting.
Yeah.
Mr. Larrea responded, "Let's talk." Mr. Larrea sent further messages. Now, I've taken Your Honour through that in the skeleton argument. Your Honour said it's not helpful to do it. But currently, Your Honour is asking, is there anything which could be said to be a specific representation that Mr. Hague is being offered a job? No, there isn't. The closest one gets is paragraph 103.
That's the key, isn't it?
Defendant received numerous calls from Mr. Arreaz and Mr. Patel to discuss what new role the claimant would offer him. In these conversations, Mr. Arreaz and Mr. Patel told the defendant that they wanted him to be given a role heading up a new London office, and all that remained for the defendant to do was to meet Dr. Khalid Al-Khazaraji, a newly appointed influential member of the GFH Board of Directors, Dr. Khalid, in Dubai, so that he could personally sign off on the defendant's appointment as the new head of a London subsidiary.
Yes.
And the defendant repeatedly asked Mr. Patel and Mr. Arreaz what the meeting with Dr. Khalid, whom the defendant would entail. The response was it was simply to discuss the position that the budget had already been approved by GFA to open the London subsidiary. Between 10-12 May 2014, seeking further assurances, the defendant contacted Mr. Nuruddin to discuss the opportunity and to remind him about the outstanding monies that the first defendant was owed. The defendant sent a message to Mr. Nuruddin on 12th of May, telling him that Mr. Arreaz had asked him to fly to Dubai to meet Dr. Khalid. Mr. Nuruddin replied to him stating, "Go." Now, of course, one of the problems, and the reason that I take you on to the WhatsApp conversations, is when one looks at the reality of the WhatsApp conversations, they paint a very different picture to what Mr. Hague is alleging at that
point. I see that.
And that is very important when Your Honour considers whether he has any real prospect of establishing at trial the wholly unparticularised assertion that on unspecified dates and times, over 8 days between the 3rd and 11th of May of 2014, he received numerous calls in which Mr. Arreaz and Mr. Patel made any specific offer to him that he would have a new job within the claimant. And the other reason that this is important is because as regards the general counsel's role, Your Honour will have seen in the WhatsApp conversations, and I've highlighted the passages in my skeleton argument, Your Honour can consider it, Mr. Hague was the first to raise the possibility of being general counsel, and Mr. Arreaz was anything other than warm about the prospect. All that he said eventually was, "Let's talk about it." That became, when Mr. Hague was messaging Mr. Patel, "Hisham has been talking to me about the general counsel spot." Now, I don't know whether Mr. Hague has a propensity for turning preliminary discussions into firm offers. But he has to show, we don't have to show that he has no reasonable prospect that at some point at trial he will show something that's said by somebody. He has to show what he intends to establish at trial was said. And paragraphs 103 to 106. Now, wholly lacking in particulars of what it is said was said by whom and when. I mean, it's not suggested that there was a conference call between Mr. Haig and Mr. Arreaz and Mr. Patel, and yet Your Honour sees the third sentence of paragraph 103. Second sentence, in these conversations, Mr. Arreaz and Mr. Patel told the defendant that they wanted him to be given a new role heading up a new London office. Well, which one of them said what and when? The defendant repeatedly asked Mr. Patel and Mr. Arreaz, well, which of them did he ask and when? The response was simply that it was simply to discuss the position and that a budget had already been approved. Well, which of them said it and when, allegedly? Between 10th and 12th of May, Mr. Haig is alleged to have contacted Mr. Nuruddin to discuss what he describes as the opportunity, not the new role, and to remind him about the outstanding monies. The defendant sent a message to Mr. Nuruddin on the 12th of May. Mr. Nuruddin replied, go, what is the context? As Your Honour sees from the WhatsApp messaging between Mr. Arreaz and the defendant and Mr. Patel and the defendant.
Yeah, but I'm sorry, Mr. Bodner, but the key paragraphs are 103, 104, 108, 109, 111, 115, 119, and then 136A.
Well, 108.
That's really what it comes to. And the question is,
yes,
taking those paragraphs at face value for the moment, without challenging whether or not, in the light of the WhatsApp messages,
yes,
they are credible, is there a sufficient plea there?
Yes.
In those paragraphs to give rise to the assertion in paragraph 136A, little one and little two, and if that's sufficient, does that in itself, or is it capable of amounting to an allegation of the tort of deceit?
Yes.
Now, that's really what I would like to be addressed on, whether you do that now or after we break is a matter of you.
I hadn't noticed the time. Perhaps if I briefly deal with those paragraphs in light of Roman 1 and Roman 2 in paragraph 136.
Yes, thank you.
So paragraph 108 talks about the defendant discussing the role and yes, various terms of employment and impressing Dr. Khalid. That's not a representation he was to be offered in the position. He still has to impress Dr. Khalid.
Yes.
Paragraph 109. Clear inference from the defence discussions on 11th and 12th May was that the meeting with Dr. Khalid was going to be a mere formality to be given. That's the defendant's impression. That's not a representation.
Well, it matters not, because we're still subject to Dr. Khalid saying yes, which is probably the key.
And what I can do is deal with it then in one sentence. At no point before the 18th of May is Mr. Haig ever told Dr. Khalid has signed off on. Indeed, the whole point of the meeting,
yes,
is that he must impress Dr. Khalid.
Okay.
And every one of the paragraphs where Mr. Haig talks about phone calls, it's phone calls where Mr. Haig is asking for guidance on how,
yes,
to impress
indeed
Dr. Khalid. So, far from being offered a new position, what Mr. Haig was told was he could have a job interview. Secondly, it was necessary to travel to Dubai. I'm not even sure that he does actually plead anything with respect to travelling to Dubai, save for paragraph 106, with Mr. Patel saying, when do you want your flights to DXB booked?
Yes, well, it's tolerably plain that it was just a question of convenience as to where the meeting was to take place.
Quite. And in the WhatsApp conversations, Your Honour would have seen Mr. Haig himself say,
yes,
I intend to be in Dubai on such and such days. So, I make the submission, I hope with assistance to Your Honour, that actually he doesn't actually plead that anybody ever offered him a job. He pleads that he was led to believe that it was in the bag and he just had to play the game for a job interview. But that's not actually a representation that he was being offered a new position. And there's certainly no representation in those paragraphs that he would be paid all monies owing to him. Nor indeed would Your Honour expect that there is such a representation, since we've been resisting his counterclaim for 3 years now. But on the very narrow question that Your Honour puts to me, and I was trying not to take a nice point or plea of detail, but on the very narrow question Your Honour puts to me, paragraph 136 isn't actually supported by the preceding paragraphs of the Honour's analysis. Now, the next question, and this will be the last thing I say before the short adjournment, the next question that may be put is, Mr. Haig being a litigant in person, should he not be given some latitude that would not be given to a professional lawyer? To which the answer is not only the various matters I raised with respect to the Milo plea, but now we are at the core of Mr. Haig's case. This is a case he has put before, or sought to put before, the City of Westminster Magistrates Court to launch criminal process. This is the case that he has put in the media. And this is the case that he has said is just there on the tip of his tongue. But he's been either too ill, too detained, or too occupied to articulate it. And this is the case which he was given the opportunity to articulate. Now, of all of the things that one might expect to be properly particularised here, that one might expect this to have chapter and verse, and it's missing. Your Honour, would that be a convenient moment? I'm sorry, yes. I hope you might enter the lunch.
No, that's all right. Now, where are we going after the adjournment?
I think I've said as...
It's really, we're then into conspiracy, aren't we?
We are into conspiracy, and so far as the facts are concerned,
The
Your Honour has said
you've dealt with essentially the unlawful means, because
yes,
they're encapsulated, are they not, in the malicious prosecution, false imprisonment of the deceit points?
Well, in terms,
yes,
paragraph 136b is conspiracy to injure by deceit, unlawful arrest, and imprisonment,
yes,
and unlawful arrest.
So what remains is then 136c, the conspiracy by
lawful
means.
Yes.
And the question is, well, you need to deal with that. Beyond that, what else is there that's...
Well, drug abuse process, and then one is finally into the actual counterclaims in respect to the employment contract,
yes,
and the amendments to the defence,
well,
the exercise of discretion. What I submit is that, so far as the application for joinder of parties is concerned, they rather stumble forward with the application for permission to amend. So if, for example, Your Honour is minded to find...
The individual defendants.
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez.
Yes, Your Honour has already cleared the UAE under the IRC authority of the deck. So if Your Honour is minded to permit Mr. Haig to pursue an allegation that Mr. Alvarez and Mr. Patel are guilty of conspiracy, then so be it, then that obviously must be joined. If Your Honour is minded not to permit that, and there is no claim within the employment contract and the commission counterclaim, but... So I think we're in good shape to finish.
The law is, isn't it, that directors can conspire with the company of which they're directors. There's only an issue where you've got the alter ego of the company conspiring with the company. Have I got that right?
It's a complex area. And what I would say is this, so far as that is concerned, it would be very nice to be able to knock out the allegation on that technical argument. The law is far from clear on that. I haven't developed it.
I think that what I've just put to you is perhaps the clearest, albeit perhaps the most simplistic view.
Yes. And the reason I'm pausing is because Mr. Haig isn't here.
No.
Your Honour has the opportunity, it has the option of simply dismissing his application because if he's not going to attempt to move it, so be it. But we're not taking that approach.
No.
I do need to be cautious about inviting Your Honour to proceed to strike out any part of the pleading on the basis that it is wrong in law, when in fact that area of law is a complex and difficult one, which is very often fact-specific.
Absolutely, but if broadly speaking what I've suggested is right,
yes.
We have here two distinct directives.
Yes.
One might be said to be the alter-ego, but there's no evidence of that, so I'm not going down that route, albeit that Mr. Haig claims that essentially Mr. Alvarez makes all the decisions.
Well, that's not alter-ego.
But it isn't alter-ego, exactly the same. So I think we're in a position where an allegation is being made against two directors and the company that they conspired together.
Yes.
And whether that be right or wrong as a matter of law, at the end of the day, it's an arguable position as a matter of law.
That's the point.
And one would be unlikely to strike out a case on that basis.
And what I would also say is this, if I were representing Mr. Haig, not for a moment suggesting that what's going to happen, one might anticipate if I were also representing Mr. Alvarez, but from a matter of abstract theory, it would be open to GFH to plead a defence to such a claim that on, insofar as it did happen, Mr. Alvarez and Mr. Patel were on a frolic of their own.
Yes, certainly, in fact, defrauding the company. Yes.
Or whatever, or that the name of the company has no liability for their actions.
Yes, yes, yes.
Now, I'm not saying for a moment that's actually going to be the position.
No, 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 sure.
Taking
but it's,
that in effect.
It is a theoretical possibility.
Yes. Taking those two points, that's why I haven't pursued a, even if there is a conspiracy, even if there is wrongdoing here, it's not a conspiracy, it's not a contemptuous scenario.
All right. How long do you want to adjourn for? Are you happy to come back at 2?
Can I say 2:15?
Just depends how long you need, really. You've got to get a bite to eat, I understand, so have
I. Not just us. I have in mind also the court staff.
They're very long suffering. Very patient and put up with the vagaries of the judges here.
I also have in mind Your Honour. Now, if we say 2:15, then it should be finished with the time.
With time of judgment.
Yeah. I don't anticipate being nearly as long on the balance of these matters.
No. All right. All right. Well, let's say 2:15 then. Thank you very much indeed.
All rise.
Observation,
isn't it? It is. Come on, let's get out of it.
Not to be proper one.
Let's get out of it quickly.
We'll leave everything as it is.